So spiders are creepy, or at least I think they're a bit unsettling, and so do a lot of other people, which is why there's a lot of spider horror movies out there. But instead of watching an entire movie, I thought I would do a trailer reaction for an old movie called Earth vs. the Spider, or just the Spider, whichever you prefer, I guess. Okay, let's take a look at this trailer. That's what we used to call our neighbor's garage. What's that noise?
What's that noise?
It's the wind.
I don't know.
Oh, it's the spider. What kind of spider noise is that? I really like these superimposing shots where you like put the film of a spider on top of the film of the people. I think it's a neat little special effect. Take that, man! See, I think that looks pretty good. Skin crawling excitement. Oh my gosh. Everyone's running. See, that just looks like a picture of a spider. Oh, I think I inhaled some popcorn. Oh. They don't make trailers like that anymore. Probably for good reason.
So this may come as a surprise to anyone who has ventured through my catalog of videos over the past few years, filming spiders with macro lenses that let me get incredibly close to these eight-legged animals, or just filming all these crazy spiders in the Bornean jungle for this video. But I would consider myself arachnophobic. Something about them I find unsettling. Though I am a strange case where different arachnids I feel uneasy around, and others I don't. Spiders? No. Scorpions? Scorpions are cool, like land lobsters with a sting. Mites and ticks? Not really, maybe just too slow moving and small. Sulpugids? Definitely not. Whip scorpions? Eh, vinegaroons are like land lobsters, so fine. Tailless whip scorpions? Really cool looking, but move too fast. Short-tailed whip scorpions? Never encountered one, but no. Pseudoscorpions? I love pseudoscorpions. They're like tiny, cute scorpions that can't sting. Hooked tick spiders? On the fence. Opiliones? Not bad, too much like a living cartoon animal to take seriously with that tiny body and then long thread-like legs. Micro whip scorpions? Kind of a fun creature. So there you go, an arachnophobic biologist reviews the existing arachnid orders. However, why are people uneasy around spiders? Well, that is a nope. Which orders bother me and which ones don't seems arbitrary and with no real logic behind it. Which, yes, fair, arachnophobia is the irrational fear of spiders, so it doesn't have to make sense. But why? Is it as some claim that early hominids who were uneasy around all spiders were less likely to be bitten by the handful of medically significant species, and so were more likely to reproduce, and so some of us today carry that legacy? Or is it entirely cultural? Is it spider attack movies, seeing our parents freak out when a spider is in the house? I mean, you probably can pick out this really well-camouflaged spider in the jungles of Borneo. And though this ability of people to find spiders quickly in images has been taken as evidence of an evolutionary response, maybe that can be driven by flexibility in how the brain can perceive the world around us, and we have been trained from a young age to find the spider. Some of you, though, may take all my footage of spiders as evidence I do not have arachnophobia. But that is because, as a biologist, I do find spiders interesting, and actually going out to film spiders and make YouTube videos documenting them has acted as a form of exposure therapy, desensitizing me by interacting with spiders in a neutral or positive way. And so today, I'm not super bothered by spiders. Yes, I still feel uneasy, and all bets are off if they touch me. Which brings me to the main point of this video that I have been building up to. I think I'm ready to challenge my fear of spiders and handle a wild spider. Hopefully have a nice, positive experience. And I can be that much more comfortable with the fact that, what is it, you're always, like, within a meter of a spider? We need a big spider, because that's more intense, and few large spiders are more well-known than tarantulas. especially the Arizona blonde tarantula, a beast of the desert night, and the animal I plan to hold.
Well, it's come to the part of the video that everyone's here for. An arachnophobe handles a big spider. I'm here with Spencer from my wild backyard, who I'll probably defer to continually through this video on making sure I'm doing this okay. So right here is a, looks like a male Arizona blonde. We're here in the Sonoran Desert with, I don't know, that's pretty good legs. Okay, I guess I just let the spider walk out?
Yep.
Or
just be a surface for him to walk on.
Okay.
Be an extension of his environment. All right. And I just kind of coax him into your hand, flat on top, just gently. He might run.
No, I don't like this.
Here, all right. Come nice on. And calm.
Oh, here we go.
All right.
Come on.
Slowly scoop him up. Slowly. There you go.
Okay.
There you go. Now just keep putting one hand in front of the other. Just be a surface for him to walk on. Because it, honestly, the fall is the most dangerous thing.
Because they're so big that they, they're actually quite fragile.
Yep.
These males, they just sort of, they do a lot of wandering. I don't know if we're quite to the wandering part of the year. You can feel the little grippy. Okay, this isn't that bad. I was honestly expecting a little bit more fear, but I think I got it in my head that, hey, I'm gonna hold a big old spider. That's gonna all be good.
You'll notice the bottom of his cephalothorax is extremely velvety. Like one of the softest things you'll
ever
feel.
I mean, they're very soft. This is a very soft animal. Oh.
It's all right. Yeah, he didn't like that. You okay?
Yeah, I'm good. More worried about the spider, so that's good. That's what we want. You want me more worried about the spider than, maybe that's what's doing it, is I'm more worried about harming this little gentleman. Very soft, like, I don't know, like it's like velvet. It's like a baby kitten puppy soft.
Since that went surprisingly well, I wanted to test a statement I made earlier. Scorpions? Scorpions are cool, like land lobsters with a sting.
Well, since I did a tarantula, and I said that I was not, my arachnophobia did not extend to scorpions. Here's a scorpion to test that. This is a desert hairy scorpion, the largest scorpion in North America. I've always liked them, so we'll see. I've been told that if they sting, it's only like a bee sting, so okay, I guess that's better than something like an Arizona bark or a deathstalker scorpion, but yeah, so I'm going to attempt to handle the scorpions, so I have been told, get them calm on the branch. Okay, I am holding a scorpion. Put my other hand here, just in case the scorpion decides to make a move for it. I guess it's, yeah, just respect the fact that that sting is very visible and right there. But, I mean, look at this. This is a scorpion just chilling, nice and relaxed. I'm gonna go into a meditative state and relax as well.
Now, thanks to Spencer from My Wild Backyard and Zachary from Life's Wild Adventures, I had some advice on how to properly handle these animals, and while the tarantula was definitely safe to handle, please do not take this video as an endorsement of handling random arachnids. They want to go about their day and not be in the hands of a potential predator. But I faced my fears, so hopefully that is inspirational to you or something. And maybe, I don't know, you could subscribe to the channel or at least like this video. Please, I held a scorpion. So now that hopefully we are more comfortable within a spider-infested world, we can talk about the impact of spiders on global ecosystems and our lives, because we only care about what spiders can do for us, not what we can do for the spiders. Well, spiders are one of the most abundant predators of insects, because there's a f***ing lot of spiders out there. Some orb weavers catch an average of 7 grasshoppers per day per web, and then roughly 6 webs per meter. So that's 42 grasshoppers per day per square meter, which, as long as you are not being hit by a plague of locusts, probably makes a bit of a dent on these pest insects. Perhaps more important than the sit-and-wait web spiders, ground-dwelling spiders are often found in higher concentrations and have been shown to have noticeable effects on pest insects. And in fact, the spiders don't even need to kill pest insects to have a noticeable effect on them. In the 1980s, a series of studies used spiders and grasshoppers to explore the concept known as the landscape of fear, which sounds like a terrible B-movie. However, is the idea that fear of predation alters prey behavior, which drastically changes how the ecosystem functions. In the biological study, Behaviorally Mediated Trophic Cascades, Effects of Predation Risk on Food Web Interactions, the authors demonstrated in a patch of grass without spiders, grasshoppers spent most of their time low in the grass, stuffing themselves silly. But the mere presence of spiders, which, because nobody seems to care about the ethics of dealing with arthropods, had their feeding appendages disabled by glue, so that's kind of sad. But the mere presence of these spiders radically changed how the grasshoppers acted, spending less time low in the grass and more time on taller forbs, and reduced their biomass intake by a quarter. In other experiments with spiders, apparently someone settled a bunch of spiders in people's homes in South Africa and showed a decline of 99% of flies, which, unlike the harmless spiders, were disease vectors, and they reported a decline in disease among those in spider-infested homes. Which basically says you should let your house get infested with spiders, and let them do their thing, I guess. Now, the thing is, spiders are most effective at controlling pests in situations with less human impact. Pesticides, overmanaging fields, all reduce spider densities, and the best results were detected in abandoned fields or agroforestry systems. So, if we make the agricultural system more friendly for spiders, they can reduce pests and help us out. A nice symbiotic circle. Thank you so much for watching this episode on wildlife misconceptions and taking on one that finally bothers me, because I like ants, and I find the ocean interesting rather than scary. But spiders do unsettle me. Hopefully seeing me take on my arachnophobia was inspiring if you are arachnophobic, and maybe get it to a level where we can at least tolerate spiders in our lives. I have one more episode in this series I want to do, especially since I've been doing this whole old sci-fi film gimmick, and there are so many about giant insects bringing about an apocalypse. But in reality, it is the absence of these insects that will bring about the end of the world. ¶¶